You can't do that. If you do that, you guarantee a thermonuclear war, chemical, biological, scalar war that's going to end civilization on this planet. You cannot divide the land of the state of Israel. You have to have an inclusive government that can include Arabs and Christians and Jews and people from Baha'i and whatever, and Palestinians, and you have to not make them feel like third world citizens, or that if they intermarry, you know, or whatever, or if they evangelize, they're going to end up in jail or whatever. In other words, you have to have dialogue between people, not have a apartheid, which is what they have there.
I haven't understood you there personally. If you're saying that the state of Israel becomes divided, what's the connection between that and the inevitability of a huge war?
Because Israel will be pushed to the point when the conflict reaches its culmination that it will start the trigger for a thermonuclear conflict.
Between who?
Between all of these great nations. It's a bipolar world. We have right now the Western alliance of the Illuminati with, you know, Britain and America and all of their allies. Mm-hmm. And on the other side, we have the Shanghai Cooperation Group with Russia, China, and all of their sphere of influence. So it's not a unipolar world, it's a bipolar world. Mm-hmm. Okay? And people need to know this. One of the things that happened back in the spring of 1999, I was taken supernaturally actually through the ground and saw the geological formations and the oil at the southwest end of the Dead Sea. And there's a lot of oil there. 27.2 trillion barrels. And it's renewable. Okay? And it's from the fault line that runs all the way from Turkey right through to Kenya to Lake Victoria. Okay? And the Dead Sea itself was created when the oil came up, the magma actually from the oil field. Magma hit along that fault line when the earth shifted back at the time of Abraham. It actually hit that fault line and caused an explosion equivalent to 500,000 Nagasakis. Hmm. The guy that told me that was the head of the Israeli oil company. Hmm. Okay, FICO, who discovered all the oil fields in Zohar, all the oil fields down in the Sinai Peninsula. I was asked to go over there when I, you know, gave this one of my presentations on the radio show with Stan Johnson. By Hayseed Stevens and the Israeli Oil Company and Ariel Sharon. I was actually asked to go to Israel and say a prayer at the southwest end of the Dead Sea at the bottom of Mount Sodom, which I did on Rosh Hashanah, right at sundown, and blow the shofar and actually say this Hebrew prayer. And I did that, and I warned them. I said, no, I'm a prophet, and I'm telling you, if you try to expose to the world that this oil is here, you're going to precipitate an immediate war. You're going to have millions of people coming in here, because there's more oil there than the whole world put together. Right?
Okay, but you're exposing that right now.
I'm exposing it now because it has to be exposed. Okay. It's a time now to expose it because what's going on now is there's a number of things in motion now that probably in less than a year they're going to sign the final treaty. Mm-hmm. If they sign that treaty, and it's also tied to other events happening around 2012, because as we pass through the center point of the galactic plane, there's a great danger that we're going to have geomagnetic collapse of the magnetic field around the Earth. We're also going to have very, very high risk in the next, you know, several years of major solar mass ejections that trigger off super earthquakes and super tsunamis. Mm. Very, very high risk of that, okay?
Right.
Yeah. We've been told this independently.
Right.
Yeah.
So people need to know that, you know, things that happen on the spiritual level also descend and have effects on the energetic and the physical level. And as we get into wrong timelines and make wrong decisions corporately, we move along those timelines towards things that can be very destructive. So what I tell people right now is not the time to flee, but there's going to be incredible pain because they're moving toward the Amaro. I've already talked to people very reliable. They've already seen the Amaro notes in Mexico City.
Mm. So you're here in Oceanside, California, right?
Because I was told to be here.
And why? Could you?
I know partially why. The way it happened is back in February, my wife is very intuitive too. She told me, he said, Bill, we're supposed to move. I said, well, I don't want to move. I'm comfortable. So I didn't really want to move from Denver to go back home, but I was with my mom before she died in October a year ago. And so I went to sleep that night, and I said, God, tell me why. And he did. He sent me the angel, and the angel told me, you're going to go to Oceanside Vista. I said, I don't want to go there. I don't even know anybody there. There's not even any jobs there or anything that I want to do there. Right? And he said, and he started laughing at me, right, and cracking jokes, and, you know, because people need to know that they're watching us and they know the future that we don't know, right? And a lot of times we probably wouldn't do things that we want to do because some of the stuff we have to do is pretty painful and messy.
So what's going down that brings you here?
Well, part of it is being here now so you could even do this taping.
Okay.
Because there's people here that have to wake up that are going to have to hear this message to know that I'm called to actually call it what's called the sons and daughters of the Most High God. Mm-hmm. I'm one to call the witnesses. Now, I'm going to back this up a bit so you'll get an understanding of just how important this meeting is tonight. In the first century, my family were in the this 24 family cycle of the Kohanim that actually served in the temple at the time of Yeshua. And a prophecy was given directly by Emmanuel, directly to my ancestor, that was written down in the first century and passed on all the way through to my great uncle Michael, who died in the 70s. That was supposed to be given to me because I was the eldest of the eldest. His brother thought he was the one called to give this word, which is to blow the trumpet of Elijah and actually tell people about the coming new age, the new world that was going to come up, a world of peace where there wouldn't be lack or all these things. And that was passed down for almost 19 centuries, right? That person is me, okay? And the reason why I know that is because at 8 and a half, when I had my tonsil surgery done, I had a French surgeon who was operating on the Colchester County Hospital. They cut an artery in my neck and I bled to death. Okay? It was a little guillotine style thing where they pulled the tonsil through with tongs, cut it off, and I had an aberrant artery and I bled to death. And I went down the tunnel of light, and of course, the way it happened is all of a sudden I'm floating over the operating room table. I'm looking down, and I can see this little boy, and I see blood spurting everywhere, and I'm thinking, gee, that looks like me. And I didn't feel any pain. And then all of a sudden I'm standing there and I'm walking around trying to talk to the nurses and doctors and nobody would pay attention to me. So I'm getting very frustrated. So I walked toward the door. As I walked toward the door, I just went right through it. So I turned right and I walked down the hall and I saw the nursery and I saw these babies all bound up tight in their side and the nurses were trying to keep them real, because one starts, they all start to cry. And they all had little different colored blankets on them. So one baby started to cry and they all started to cry. And all of a sudden, everything started to fade into inky black, a black so black you could feel it. And I felt like I was being squinched through a pinhole, right? And then all of a sudden, I cried out, God, where am I? Something terrible's happening, right? And I saw a pinpoint of light, and all of a sudden, there was these intersecting crimson lines. And I'm going down this tunnel of light, and I said, it's too fast, God, too fast. And then all of a sudden, I'm in this place of light, and across on the other side of this space, there's a man standing there, almost glowing light. And he had a broad golden sash with a double-corded belt and his, what I call brass-like sandals. And he had, his forehead was kind of, it almost looked like there were puncture marks and it was still swollen. And you could see where his beard was plucked out. He had reddish hair, just like the best way to describe him would be a Norwegian. Only had olive-colored skin. He looked like a big, rock-hard, kind of 3% body mass, kind of carpenter with big hands and big knuckles. And he looked like a guy that could, make anything, right? Only they fell to the middle part of his arm and leg. And as he appeared, there was a big chasm appeared in these clouds because it was all light all around. And I saw this little wooden bridge. And he said, don't cross the wooden bridge or the silver cord will break. And I said, what's that? And he says, I will bring it into your remembrance. Because in other words, because you know everything. You just have to remember it. I remember going down the tunnel of light. I can remember this cord that seemed to come out from the base of my brain and my throat. And it went down. It was like a cord of water. He called it a cord of living waters. It was like a neon cord that kind of scintillated with light, right? And he said, if you go, you won't be able to return. And he said, where am I? He said, you're at the gates of paradise or heaven, the eternal now, where there is no past, no present or future, but everything that you think immediately is, right? So I said, well, can you show me? So all of a sudden, he's holding me by his right hand, and I'm flying over the Golden City, and I can see everything. And I would say, because there's no time space, he showed me worlds, beings, planets, civilizations that I'm going to talk about a little bit today, but literally the amount of things he showed me about the universe is an elemental particle in a yet larger universe. So he told me about time space, he told me about quantum physics, he told me everything. That's why I was about to go into nuclear physics at MIT. Okay? Yep. He showed me beings that, later on in life, I heard, I saw that in Star Wars, okay, because these things did exist. I saw them. I was there to their worlds. I can't tell you how long it was, but in lineal time, it had to be many centuries that I spent there. It wasn't a matter of a few minutes, like some people have these near-death experiences. I was there for an indeterminate period of time. It was so long, the amount of things, and I only talk about a very tiny portion of what I know because it's so beyond the pale of human understanding of civilizations and worlds and things that people cannot even grasp. So I don't talk about it.